chapter 5. Start at verse 21. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. And moving down to verse 33. However, each of you must also love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that it may go well with you, and that you may enjoy long life on the earth. Fathers, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord. Slaves, obey your earthly masters with respect and fear and with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey Christ. Obey them not only to win their favor when their eye is on you, but like slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from your heart. Serve wholeheartedly as if you were serving the Lord, not men. Because you know that the Lord will reward everyone for whatever good he does, whether slave or free. Masters, treat your slaves in the same way. Do not threaten them, since you know that he who is both your master and yours is in heaven. And there is no favoritism with him. Lord, we thank you for the word that you've given us and the opportunity to study it. Help us to apply it in our lives. In Christ's name. Our study has been about the mystery of Christ, which originated in the mind of God in the spiritual realm. Long before there was ever a physical realm. It was a demonstration of the spiritual world. It was a demonstration to show how he could both be just and merciful, loving God, while at the same time be able to bring punishment on those who are wrong. It was accomplished through his son Jesus and by his incomprehensible love. A love that's so hard, so deep that we have no way to really comprehend it. It reconciled us. It brought us into fellowship with him, whereas before we were lost and separated. Man's spirit must be reborn through water in the image of God. Talking about the spiritual being, not the physical being. In the image of God, who is a spiritual being. As God's children, ones that look like our Father, our view and our actions are based on our spiritual being. God's spirit within us is going to produce godly physical actions. Last week, we talked about our relationship to God. And the key to that comes back to verse 21, which follows after the scripture that says, be filled with the Spirit. Filled with the Spirit, tongues, praise, different things, submit to one another. That's a result of being filled with the Spirit. So our relationship with God is a key part of that is submitting to one another. We saw last week how Christ submitted to his bride, his church, first. Did it through sacrificing and giving of himself, not just in his life, which we see all the time, but the fact that he came here and actually lived and served his people, his bride, his people. We saw how Christ forgave the church, those that are part of his bride, of her past, and made her special, holy, not common. We saw how Christ cared and provided for his church in every possible way. On the other hand, we saw his wife, or his bride, which is the church, is to submit to him. In everything, not just some things, the things we choose, but in everything. She's to submit because Christ has been given the responsibility and the authority over the church to look after. The church is also to submit because we owe him everything we are, and everything we have, and everything about us, our complete being. As we continue on this thought of being filled with the Spirit and submitting to one another, we noted how a lot of times we think it goes into a bunch of verses about marriage, but Paul made it very clear that when he said that, actually he was referring to the relationship between God and Christ. And then after he got that point across, he said in verse 32, he said, it's a profound mystery. I'm talking about Christ and the church. However, and this is where we start today, each one of you must also love his wife as he loves himself, and my wife must respect her husband. So then he goes in and says, okay, now that you got that, that relationship between God and His church or His people, then let's talk about the husband and wife. And he goes back and basically kicks it back up and says, you know, just like we discussed, the relationship before us. So first thing he talks about, when you go back up there, and before we get too far away, I want us to hone in on this particular part of it about submission. All right? All this is preceded by verse 21, which we talked about last week, is a transition from this rebirth and the Spirit being filled with the Spirit of God and is reborn in this spiritual being. And it's followed with this transition that says, submit to one another. Submit to God, God submits to us, submit to one another. Now you're going to talk about husbands and wives and all the ones we read about. So it's a continuation of what it means to be filled with the Spirit. Where our physical being is controlled by the spiritual being. See, in the world, what controls? The physical. Always look around at all the sin and all the things that people are always talking about. We've talked about this for the entire study. The world teaches about satisfying me, my physical being. And what he's trying to do here is, when we're filled with the Spirit, we make this transition, we've been reborn in a spirit that looks like God, then our physical being is now to be controlled by our spiritual being. That's what he was saying in all these verses we've been going through. It's first seen in our spiritual relationship with God. That's why Paul emphasized that first, and then he rolls in all these other things. Because if you want to understand how that submission takes place, you've got to start there. It's the key to godly physical relationship. Okay? So if you want to have a godly physical relationship with anybody in this physical world, you got to get that submission understood. Now, to do that, what is submission? Probably should have talked about that last week since we started there. What is submission?
Bow to the will of.
Do what? To bow to the will of? Keep your thoughts under control. Anything else? Put others above yourself. Okay. We've been talking over and over about the physical and the spiritual. So we talk about the physical or the world's view. How does the world view submission? Negatively? Why? What do they think of? The boss. There you go, the boss. When they turn around and they start saying, why submit you? Oh, no, no, he's not the boss of me. It's equality. We're in America. We don't have to put up with that. And we want the rest of the world to understand that, too. Matter of fact, we argue with the Taliban and all different cultures and everything that are against that. Equality. You're not the boss of me. That's what the world thinks of. And when you think of the boss, what are you supposed to do when the boss says jump? How high? You're supposed to obey. So the world, in a physical view, looks at submission as a requirement of obedience. It's no wonder that they are opposed to submitting to your husbands or authority. I mean, we see the authority part going on all over us right now, right? All of those kind of things, they don't see that because they see it as being something about obedience. Somebody's in charge of me, and I am free. I'm the United States. I'm an American. I don't have to be in subjection or submission to anyone. That's a worldly view. The problem is, we are spiritual beings. And when we talk about submission, in the Bible, and we talk about it from a spiritual perspective, we need to understand what submission is. And a lot of you, again, are all around it. They're all on it, you know, pieces and parts of it. From a spiritual view, it's not about an action, it's about an attitude. It's a way you look at things. It's an attitude that guides our physical actions. It's the way you think about it. Keep your thoughts under control. It's a matter of putting your thoughts in the right place so that your actions will respond and you'll act according to the way you think by making a mental choice. So submission in a spiritual view is really about a choice. It's about an attitude that you're going to put in your heart, in your life, and by doing that, it will guide the way you act. That will be the rule. Instead, the world looks at it as a rule that you got to abide by, and you got to and then obey, and because of that, it's out of my rule. Furthermore, my constitution says I don't have to do that. You know, or whatever it may be. You know, some places the constitution doesn't do it, people still don't like it. And Paul's going to address that too. So we need to think about submission. It's not about authority. It's not about responsibility. Submission is about the attitude that guides your spiritual life. That's what submission is. So as we look at this relationship, and that's what it was with the relationship with the church and God, it's about that understanding of what God's done for us, so therefore we do what? We have an attitude, a view toward Him that makes us, guides our actions towards Him. Right? That's what submission to Him is. Therefore, when He says, this is how you need to live your life, we say, okay, that's how we need to live our life. Instead of like greater Christendom or the world says, well, yeah, but I don't know. That doesn't really feel good to me. You know? Because they're really not part of His church that is based on an attitude that He's put in there that is a godly attitude. All right, so as we do that, and we think about that, and we start looking now at some of the relationships we have on this earth. One of the closest relationships we have is with who? Let me rephrase that. One of the closest relationships we're supposed to have on this earth is with who? Our spouse. It's not always, but it should be. As a matter of fact, all throughout history, and that's the example that Paul uses right here when he starts looking to understand God's relationship with man, is he goes to the husband and wife because it is the closest, most intimate relationship there is. So that's the first one Paul wants to start with too. And in the flip side, he says, you know, we just have to talk about it as with God. It's the same way with your spouse. All right, so when you start talking about that, what's the first thing we think of? When we start going through this, what does it say?
Wives.
I notice every single one of these, he starts with the person that we would normally, in the worldly view, think is the person that's the underling, not the boss, is the word we use in Indigo. Wives. But when I take it, I want to take it from the other way. Because every time he does that, he turns around and says, yeah, but. Okay? So he says, yeah, wives, but husbands. Let's go back. So I want to start with husbands. So husbands, what are you supposed to do? Wives, tell us what we're supposed to do. They don't want to admit it. Love your wives. That's where it starts with it. Husbands, love your wives. Is that eros?
Agape.
Husbands, agape your wife. Love your wife. Okay? He said, so we are, as a matter of fact, he gives that illustration of Christ. And which came first? The church's submission to Christ or Christ's submission to the church? Christ's submission to the church. Christ gave everything first. Husbands, what are you supposed to do first? Everything to your wife. You're supposed to submit to her. Submit first by giving of yourself to her. Do what?
Give her a ring.
Give her a ring. She gives you. You give her a ring. She puts one in your nose.
I was thinking more kind of garbage up.
Well, my wife says the sexiest thing is for somebody to make some more dishes. I'm going, how does that fit? Different views, aren't there? Submit by first giving of yourself for her. That's what Christ. That's what it is. Husbands who say they don't submit aren't listening. Because it's an attitude that gives, that guides our physical actions. Husbands, love your wife. Submit by first giving yourself. Be forgiving. You know what Christ was? Yeah, I don't like that. I'm married. It's a lot harder to forgive. You know, it's okay to provide. I can handle that. But forgiving? Yeah, I don't know about that. Forgiving, providing, caring. For what? Every need. Every need. Not just the physical one, sometimes it's emotional. Guys, we miss that. Most of us do. Or at least I do. Maybe I'll just blame me. Okay. We miss that. Emotional? Get a grip. Is that number five? Okay. All right. So, husbands, submit first by giving yourself to her. Be forgiving, caring, provide for her in every possible need, every way that she has a need, whatever that may be. Okay. Because of that, remember it was first. Now we go back to wives. Wives, what are you supposed to do? I won't hear it from the wives. I never hear that. Submit to your husbands. Purely and clearly says that. Does it say, wives, obey your husbands? No. The word obedience is not in there. How many times have we translated that? Because what does the world think it means? Obedience. Boss. Obedience. What it says is submit. That means get an attitude that guides your physical actions towards your husband. Get an attitude where you place him above yourself. You put them first. You look not only that, but the interest of his needs. All right, wives, which includes obedience sometimes, to some degree, but not really. I mean, we'll get to that later. All right, it means yielding to him is an act of submission to God. He also goes on to clarify and say, when you do that, not only that, when you yield, it's because you're also submitting to God. So the two of them go hand in hand. Whenever you have that attitude that guides those actions, it's also an attitude of submitting to God. It says, for wives, Christ has the responsibility and authority over the church. He's the head. So wives should be in submission because what have the husbands been given? Head. He's been given the responsibility and the authority as head. That's where sometimes that little obedience comes in. Obedience is such a minor part of it. Everybody keys in on that. Because that's not exactly what it means there. Alright, so here it is. It's about the head as far as responsibility and authority. And when it comes to the home, the family, it's got to be there. Have you ever seen a government that didn't have anybody in charge? What is it called? Chaos, anarchy. Okay? What happens when you've got a business and nobody's in charge? Same thing. Well, the businesses eventually fail. Somebody's got to be, I think Reagan had a thing on his desk that said, what? The buck stops here. Somebody's got to have the final say sometimes. And it's the same thing in a relationship, in any of these relationships, actually. But in the case we're talking about a husband and wife. There's got to be a final responsibility and authority. God has designated the man. And in other places, he says why he picked him. Whether it's a good choice or not, we can argue that, but God is God. So sometimes we need to just accept. All right. So wives, submit to your husbands. Yielding him is an act of submission to God and respect the responsibility that God placed upon him. Next one he talks about is our families. And he starts off, he says, children. But I want to start with, which came first, children or fathers? Parents. All right, so fathers, do not exasperate your children. What does that mean? I know most of us skip that verse. I know, Sue, that means quit poking Mary Beth. It's fun to watch your reaction. What does it mean to exasperate your children? Actually, I think another version does say
provoke, does it?
Yeah. Don't provoke your children. Don't poke at them or cause them to have problems. It's not about the playful poking. It's about causing issues or whatever there.
Causing them to be frustrated, like they can't do anything right.
There you go. Can't make them feel like they can't do anything right because cause frustration. Parents' primary responsibility is to do what? He tells you right in the next part of the verse. Bring them up to the Lord, love and admonish, train and instruct. I mean, go back to Deuteronomy. Tie it on the heads, write it on the doorsteps. I mean, it's about taking this little baby that can't do anything and bringing him up and making him an adult. Not just physical being, but spiritual being too. That's why he emphasizes in the Lord. Okay? Okay, so the purpose of a parent is to train and instruct. That's what their job is. So if that's their job, then they need to concentrate on that in such a way that gets that done. Have you ever seen a rebellious child learning and following after instruction? No. So if you do things as a parent that causes rebellion in your child, by provoking them or exasperating them to where you're not able to train and instruct, are you doing your job? No. And sometimes we do things that we don't have to do. But we do it in the process, all it does is build up resentment and rebellion. So when we look at it as a parent, we need to be thinking about that. Are we everything we do, is it actually instructing and training up the child in the Lord? Is it accomplishing that goal? Is it working toward that goal? If it's crossways with it, then you need to rethink it. All right, children, obey your parents. How do you do that? What are you supposed to do? What's the first commandment with promise? Well, that's the result. What is the commandment?
Honor.
Honor your parents. Honor. What does that mean? Show them the respect. Show them the respect. That means as far as in obedience, that's part of it, right? Show respect, proper respect for what they have done and the responsibility they've been given. They're due it. They've been, they've earned it. They definitely will if they survive 18, 20 years, 25 years, 30, whatever it is nowadays, with your children. Okay? Show them respect. Does that mean it quits as soon as you get up to 18 and you leave the house and now you're on your own? What happens if they're 80 and you're 60? Doesn't quit. Keep on doing it. Respect. One of the biggest problems in this country, in my opinion, is we don't show respect to our parents. And we provoke our children. We're not training them and bringing them up. And when you break down the family, what happens to society? It breaks down too. Now, everybody knows that, but you can't get any intellectual to tie all of society's ills to that problem. You know what I mean? Instead, they try to justify the situations of the families today. Okay? So children, obey your parents. It's the only way, and as the promise says, it's the one with promise. Live long and prosper. You've heard this thing? Do what? Well, that was prop. Well, he stole it then. That it may go well with you and you may enjoy a long life. Now, this is the exact quote. Alright? As a matter of fact, I've heard a million times, what is it? It brought you in? Take it out. There's one way of shortening your life real quick. Back in those days, the rebellious child was stoned. They meant it literally, as well as figuratively. But in addition to that, if a child will listen, show the respect and obedience as it is trained and instructed, guess what? It becomes an adult, it will live a long, successful life because it has allowed the parent to do their job, properly train and instruct. And that way, that will be a long life on the earth. Try to keep you strictly with the call. All right. That's the family. All right. Next place, it says slaves and masters. We don't really have that happen in the U.S., but it applies in a lot of places in the world. But in our relationship, it's still the same. We have employers and employees. Same difference. It's one who is in charge of the business, whatever that may be, and the ones who work for that person. So we look at that. First thing that I would do is go down to verse 9, and it talks about employers, or the people in charge of the business. It says, employers, treat your employees as if they were Christ himself. It talks about that verse before that. It says, do not threaten them. What does it mean by that?
Bless you.
Do not threaten or cause them to fear for their livelihood. Don't give them ultimatums. Right. Don't be pushing them to a point that they fear for everything. And it's not just a threatening, it's one that they actually are fearful for their life or their way to survive. And in the slave's case, it was critical that they thought they would die because if the master didn't take care of them, they would die. In an employee situation, an employee without a job can't provide for a family, home, or anything else. So it's constantly putting them in fear of that. That's not what God wants us to do. That's not the right attitude. The attitude is one of submission to them. You got our attitudes. Instead, we are to remember that God is the master of who? Everyone. And he's the rewarder of everyone. That's one thing I try to remind my employees when I try to tell them, well, you need to do what we say. We got to do certain things, certain ways, certain this, certain that. It's one of the things I always try to stress. We have to do that. And if you don't like it, I'm sorry. Sometimes that's just the way it is. The reality is we all have a boss. And I point out that I have a boss, that's the people I work for. It gives me the jobs, I mean construction gives me the jobs in order for me to employ you. And it's that way wherever it is, everybody has a boss. So we're always an employee, even if we are an employer. Okay? So then remember that, and it's God is the one that provides the success and the one that rewards both. Employees says, obey your masters with respect, fear, and sincerity of heart. Okay? Respect and sincerity of heart. That's hard to do. A lot of times we rather just go in and get it done, shouldn't we? Don't we? Yeah, especially if we don't like our workplace environment or something, right? Or maybe the boss is a jerk or whatever it may be. You know? Maybe the work rules aren't something to your liking, whatever they may be. But the fact of the matter is, how are you supposed to do it? You're supposed to do it as in, with respect and sincerity of heart. Oh, you mean I gotta be sincere too? I can't just go through the motions to get the job done and leave at the 3:30 whistle. 3:29 if I can sneak out, but never 3:31. No. Respect and sincerity of heart. Keep in mind that all things aside, they are the provider that's giving you an opportunity to provide for your family. You may not like it. In our country, if you're not in the slave situation, you always have the opportunity and the option to make a change. Sometimes a change is worse. But that option is there. So we need to do that. So as employees, obey and win the favor of your boss as a service to God. Guess what? When you do things that makes the employer happy, what happens? Not all the time. Most of the time, you get the benefit of that, don't you? He shows the favor on you. Serve wholeheartedly. hardly, because it is the Lord who does the rewarding. It's not the boss who's giving you the reward. It's not his pat on the backs. It's not his signing the check at the end of the week. Because all of that ultimately comes from God. So just remember, he's the one who's provided that opportunity there by providing the employer to actually give you a job, whatever that may be. Because he can take away from the employer that fast. Okay? And the last thing I wanted to mention, and it's not in here, but while we're doing it, I want to make sure we get them all. Paul talks, tells us in Romans chapter 13, verse 1 through 5, to submit to all authorities. See, that's one he didn't mention here because these were more familiar type relationships, but he also talks about that. Those in authority are to be God's servant for good. So as you're in a position of authority, whether it's in a small government, like a city government, or you're the president of the United States, whatever it is, your purpose for being there is to be the servant for good. What he tells us in Romans chapter 13. They are there to do whose will? God's will. You mean Nebuchadnezzar was there to do God's will? Yes, he was, even though he went and burned Jerusalem and slaughtered and did all the things he did. It was his will. He was in place for that. Sometimes we don't recognize those kind of things, but all authorities are there to do God's will. Even if we don't see it. Keep that in mind when you look at the world around you today. They are not supposed to be there to terrorize the righteous. Do they? Some authorities? Absolutely. From a place in this world, that's all they do is terrorize those who are the innocent. But that's not the job. If you're in a government or an authority position in the government in one form or another, your job is not to terrorize the righteous. It's not your job. Okay? Instead, if you are one of who is in, like most of us are, has a government that is over us, we're to submit to the governing authorities. Whether they be great or small, little or big, righteous or unrighteous in my view. Okay? In fact, he tells us to give them their due, whether it be revenue, taxes, respect, and honor. Nebuchadnezzar, do you your respect and honor? Yes. How about taxes? Yep. Give it to them. Okay? And it says, do not be rebellious and bring judgment upon yourself. We understand that real clearly when we're talking about when you have a good government. But what do you want when it's a bad government? Is it okay to be rebellious then? Let's go back to what submission means. Submission, not in the world, but in the spiritual view, is an attitude that guides our physical actions. So that means don't be rebellious. Our government gives you the opportunity to say something, okay, make a statement. And then, what do they say, shut up and sit down? Don't go through, yeah. Don't go burning buildings. Don't be laying out in the middle of highways and causing people to have accidents or whatever you may be. Don't be rebellious. Be in submission to the authorities. All right. That's the last one, love. Any other thoughts on that? Let me take a minute or two and kind of give you some practical stuff. First thing is, every single one of these, they say, I'll go to the wives first, to submit to your husband as to the Lord. Parents, obey your parents children, obey your parents in the Lord. Slaves, obey them not only to win their favor when their eyes on you, but like slaves of Christ, serving the Lord. Every single one of these submissions that he talks about is in the Lord, or for the Lord, in the Lord. It's all that. All related. So every requirement about submission is key to the Lord, to Christ. Guess what? Who submitted the most? Christ. Okay? As a matter of fact, one of my favorite verses I like to read is found in 1 Peter chapter 2. And There's a whole section in there, but verse 21 says, to this you were called, because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example to follow. He that committed no sin, no deceit was found in him, in his mouth. When they hurled insults at him, what did he do? He did not retaliate. When he suffered, he did what? Made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. When we submit in the Lord, it's saying submit just like the Lord did. Even on this earth, even when things aren't right, even if it's to the unrighteous that are in control, submit to that, submit to God's will. He's in control of everything. Instead, what are we to do? Leave it to who? Righteous judge. What is man's preference? I can handle it. Let's just go out back. I can handle it. I can figure out a way to break you financially. I can handle it. We'll divorce and separate in such a way that you will be miserable the rest of your life. Yes, sir.
Is there a balance to be found with what you're saying? Because our founding fathers didn't submit. Our founding fathers of this country did not submit to the governing rule that was over them. And I don't think that they were unchristian-like by doing what they did. Because one of the things that they were after was freedom of religion and freedom of some other things as well. So I think that there's a balance. I think there's a balance there. I don't think that I'm wrong being part of the military to go overseas to take away and take down a ruler like Saddam Hussein when we went over and kind of went into Iraq and took him out of power. I understand what you're saying as far as everyone's in rule because God says so. But I think that there's a balance somewhere.
Let me just tell you what I see. First of all, the military is an arm of the
government.
Authorities. God clearly says he puts the authorities in place in order to bring about his justice. He sends them, he controls them, whatever. So from a military standpoint, it has nothing to do with it. As far as the revolution goes, individually, were they in submission to the authorities? The answer is still no. But as a people, they made a decision to do whatever. Was it right, wrong, whatever? All I can say is this. Who's in charge? God. Doesn't he use all good, all bad, all whatever? Good intentions, whatever they may have had, you know, and go from there. So I can't answer that, but I can say from an individual standpoint, when he talks about submission, it's an attitude that we use to guide how we do these things. All right? Right. Well, there are times, and especially when it affects the biblical. Let me wrap something up here real quick. All right, a couple quick thoughts for whatever when we're talking about this. We see how Jesus did it. A couple quick illustrations. In a marital relationship, if you submit to each other, but at some time there is the place where the responsibility goes to the one. I've said this before, whenever I use the three vote deal or whatever, basically I vote, she has a vote, I have an extra vote. Most of the time I let her do it. That's called submission. On the other times with God, there's a time that I have to make the final decision, the buck stops there, I do. Is that the right way to do it? I don't know. But basically, and I think it kind of shows the general concept of submitting to each other. So most of the time, even though I may have three votes or two votes, it doesn't necessarily mean that I have three votes because I give them up by submitting. Just like God, Christ had the power not to die on the cross, not to give himself, not to do anything, but he willfully made that choice. But in the end, guess what? He will make a decision. Okay? Next thing is this. We talk about our family. My wife has taught me this over the years, whatever. Choose your battles. Whether you're a child and want to argue against your parents, choose your battles. When you're a parent, choose your battles. If you fight and stand on every little thing, guess what you're going to have? friction and rebellion and problems, and you will not accomplish the goal. Pick your battles, whether you're a child or a parent. Workplace. Many years ago, I was put in the position that I was a young guy, building nuclear power plants, but a young guy with a lot of responsibility, and here I am 22 or whatever, and I got these guys at 50 engineers working for me. Some people had their own mindset about how to do things. So I had an idea of the way I thought it ought to be done, and so when I gave it to my boss, you know what I did? I used this illustration. I've used it many times since then. Here's what I think, but it's your ball. You bounce it. I provided my input. I've done what I need to do, and I've showed the proper respect, and I let them, they got the information to make the decision, Mike. But at the end of the day, it's the boss's ball. You know what I mean? Play the game. That's how you know how that relationship goes. Last thing, in authorities, remember, and I touched on this when I was talking to Mark, it's not about me. It's about God. Many times we try to make it about me, it's about God. All right. James 4, you write this down and go back and look at it. James 4, chapter, verses 7 and 8, it says, submit yourselves to God, humble yourself, and he'll lift you up. Keep your hands and heart clean. Resist the devil and he'll flee from you. Because all of this is all about submitting to God. Whatever position you find yourself in. And next week, we're going to talk about resisting the devil. Okay? As we fight this spiritual, deal with this spiritual thing. So next week, we're at lesson number 12, I believe it is. Is that right?